Just who are the Kurds? Political scientist Michael Gunter of Tennessee Tech University has more answers than most. He'll discuss them next on Global Perspectives.
This is Global Perspectives with Pulitzer Prize-winning commentator John Bercia.
Welcome to Global Perspectives. Not long ago, the Kurds were virtually unknown to most Americans. Now they're part of daily conversations, which makes the Kurdish Studies expertise of Michael Gunter especially valuable. He's a professor at Tennessee Tech University. Welcome to the show, Dr. Gunter.
Thank you.
You are known by many people as one of the foremost experts on Kurds in the entire world. Tell us how your interest in the Kurds started.
Well, if you live long enough, you eventually get known for what you're doing. But it started back in the late 70s when I was a senior Fulbright lecturer in international affairs in Turkey and became better acquainted with the Kurdish issue.
And subsequently, you have researched and lectured and written books and articles and so forth, including some fairly recent ones, one being on the Kurds in Syria. How did that project develop?
Yes, the Syria project developed. I was invited to speak a couple years ago at the Royal Institute of International Affairs in London on Syria, and I knew very little, but I said something, and it must have impressed the editor of Hearst Publishers, because afterwards he just came up to me and offered me a contract out of the blue. I was a little nervous because that wasn't my main field, Syria, but Syria was in the news because the civil war had begun, and so I said yes.
And how much did you know about the Kurds in Syria before starting that project?
Not that much. I had dealt with them a little bit, but that's why it's the title of my book, Out of Nowhere.
Mm-hmm. But you had spent a large amount of time with Kurds in Iraq and Kurds in Turkey, etc.
Right. And one time in 1998, I went to Syria to interview Abdullah Öcalan, the leader of the PKK, the Turkish Kurdish rebel group. So I had been in Syria once before.
Mm-hmm. So the civil conflict in Syria created an opportunity for you to expand your research in an unexpected way.
Yes.
And what have you learned about the Kurds in Syria that surprised you, or did nothing surprise you?
It surprised me because I think the conventional wisdom about Syria was that the Kurds were very passive and too divided, and not enough of them to really amount for an issue like they do amount in Turkey, Iraq, and Iran. And quite the contrary, for various reasons that had not been considered before, the Kurds in Syria have become one of the leading stories in the Middle East.
So where do you think the situation in Syria will lead? It seems like it's just been ongoing, open-ended conflict with no end in sight.
That's true. It's one would have to be very cautious to predict the end game there. But in my conclusion to my new book on the Kurds in Syria, I have three possible scenarios that I could get into if you want me
to.
Yeah,
sure. Indicate what they are just briefly.
The one that shocks most people, because Turkey is very anti-Syrian Kurds. But I speculate that if the current Turkish PKK peace process is successful and the PKK comes to an agreement with Turkey, the PKK is closely allied with the Syrian Kurds. So if the PKK makes a deal with Turkey and Syria falls apart, as it seems to be falling apart, it is not inconceivable that the Syrian Kurds could actually join Turkey. That's one scenario. Most people would say a more likely scenario is that the Syrian Kurds would join the Iraqi Kurds, the Kurdistan Regional Government, KRG. So that's a second scenario. A third scenario is that, in effect, we would have a second Kurdish state, that the Syrian Kurds would amount to something like the Iraqi Kurds, an autonomous unit in Syria, but maybe even more autonomous, because I think Syria is more irrevocable irrevocably broken than Iraq is.
But the Kurds in Iraq have access to resources. Do the Kurds in Syria have some sort of base from which to establish
some.
An economy?
That, not as much as in Iraq, but there's oil in Iraq, and there's oil in Syria. Unfortunately, ISIS currently has most of it, but if ISIS is defeated, this oil in northeastern Syria, some of it would certainly be available to the Kurds, depending on what the final settlement is in Syria.
And you mentioned the possibility of two Kurdish states, which is a term we're not used to hearing. Do you consider the Kurdish area of Iraq essentially a state?
Yes.
Uh-huh. And what will that lead to? Could that lead to?
I think it's just a matter of time before the Iraqi Kurds become independent. They're very judicious, and when they pick the moment, they could have picked the moment already, but there are problems with their neighbors and supply lines, and currently the Iraqi Kurds have most of the advantages of being independent without suffering the disadvantages. So why rush into things if you don't have to?
So it might benefit them to maintain the status quo for a while longer.
Yes. And then, of course, when ISIS attacked them in August 2014, it showed the KRG it wasn't quite as ready for independence as it might have thought it was.
Mm-hmm. Now, that surprised a lot of people, that that ISIS had turned its attention in the direction of Kurdistan. Did it surprise you?
Yes, maybe not as much as some people, but it did surprise me. I thought ISIS had its hands filled with the Syrian civil war and with Baghdad, the Shia Arabs in Iraq, and not needing to manufacture another enemy in the Kurds. And the Kurds had a reputation, the Iraqi Kurds, being very tough. And why would ISIS want to take on just another enemy like that? And I'm not privy to ISIS's thinking, but that's what ISIS did, and were very successful at first until the U.S. intervened with air power.
Mm-hmm. So where do you expect that situation to go, just generally? Is it improving? Is it the same? Is it getting worse? The reports seem to be very confusing.
In August 2014, ISIS came close to potentially knocking the Iraqi Kurds out, drove within 20 miles of Erbil, the capital city, and host to this airport where a month later I landed. But as soon as the U.S. bombing campaign began, ISIS was stopped and then pushed back. And now the Peshmerga, the KRG, Iraqi Kurdish military, are receiving weapons from the United States and others to successfully contain ISIS and even push ISIS back. And what we're talking about now is a possible Kurdish attempt on Mosul, the capital, not the capital, but the second largest city in Iraq, which famously ISIS captured in June 2014.
Mm-hmm.
I myself doubt that. The Kurds have no real reason to attack Mosul, other than if they're seduced into doing that by the United States, because Mosul is not really in what the Kurds consider their claimed land right now. So why would the Kurds want to fight and die in land that would then just be handed over to the Shia Arabs? So we'll have to see. Right now, the Kurds in Iraq seem to have regained all the lost territory that ISIS took in August, last August, and are even being projected to attack Mosul. And I myself find that a long stretch that the Kurds will go that far, but we'll have to see.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk a bit more about the Kurds in Turkey, which is an issue you've spent a lot of time on. What has changed there? I mean, you reference the peace process and the potential for some kind of settlement. That wasn't on the table not too long ago.
Yes, that's the big change, that the PKK had been in an active rebellion against Turkey since 1984 and even earlier, so for more than 30 years. And the hatred and lack of trust was so great, it just seemed like an impossible situation to bring the two sides together. But Prime Minister, now President Erdogan in Turkey, who's done so much for Turkey, although recently he's probably gone too far with his megalomania. But anyway, Erdogan, unlike previous Turkish leaders, with the exception of the late President Özal, Erdogan was determined to try and do something about ending the PKK insurgency. So since early 2013, there's been a formal peace process between the Turkish state and the PKK, which is absolutely amazing if you know the history of this issue. However, the peace process is stalled and neutral, and many people think it will be a failure. So, but it's still there, and possibly it will be revived.
Now, you mentioned the possibility of a partnership between the Kurds in Syria and the Kurds in Turkey, and also between the Kurds in Syria and the Kurds in Iraq. What about the possibility of all three of them joining together and possibly adding a fourth piece, the Kurds in Iran, which is...
That's highly unlikely, because the Kurds are famously divided into these four states, Turkey, Iraq, Iran, and Syria, and that's been since the end of World War I. And so in each place, the Kurds have developed a separate entity and separate history and separate conditions. So it is highly unlikely that all these four different conditions will come together so that you can have a pan-Kurdish state. Very briefly, I would say the future of the Kurds in Turkey is a democratic Turkey where the Kurds can proudly and willingly be Turkish citizens. The future in Iraq is an independent state. The future in Iran right now, the situation is very quiescent, and the future of the Kurds in Iran is we don't hear much about them right now. And in Syria, suddenly, out of nowhere, the title of my book, anything is possible for the Kurds in Syria. So in all four of these states where the Kurds live, there are different scenarios that are working out, and it's highly unlikely that all four would come together short of some total world war that absolutely redrew the boundaries in the Middle East.
Mm-hmm. The Kurds in Iran, that's a subject we almost never hear about, as you mentioned. What have you developed in terms of your research and knowledge of what they're about, and how do they fit into the structure in Iran? Are they as unhappy there as the Kurds are in other countries?
Depending on whom you listen to, yes or no. And it's up to me as a scholar to decide. My feeling is that Iran could explode eventually, but there are certain reasons why it's more quiescent in Iran right now. The Kurds are ethnically related to the Iranians. So there's a sense of being part of Iran ethnically, which the Kurds do not have with Arabs in Syria and Iraq or with Turks in Turkey. And the Iranian movement was the Kurdish movement in Iran was so thoroughly crushed in the early 1980s by the Ayatollah Khomeini's Iranian revolution that the Kurds have never fully recovered. Plus, famously, the Iranian secret agents murdered Qasem Lu and then his successor, Sarafkandi. So the Kurdish movement in Iran was successfully decapitated many years ago, and I don't think has fully recovered from that demoralization of the loss of their leaders.
Mm-hmm. After the fall of the Shah, did the Kurds in Iran see an opportunity for some kind of autonomy? Is that what drove this?
They certainly did, and it was crushed by the Iranians.
So to what extent are they in communication with the Kurds in the other countries? Do you have any information?
Oh, they are. The Iranian Kurdish rebels are located in the KRG, Iraqi Kurdistan area, because they were pushed out of Iran. And I visited the Iranian Kurdish camps in Iraqi Kurdistan. It's about an hour drive from Erbil, almost in the center of the KRG.
And what did you learn from that experience?
Well, actually, I was impressed with their leader, Mustafa Hijri, a very erudite fellow, speaks pretty good English. We were having trouble talking for a while, and somehow I mentioned Iranian literature, and his face lit up. He had studied Iranian literature in Tehran, and we had an interesting discussion on Iranian literature, of which he knew a lot more than I did, but at least I knew enough to bring the discussion along. And he's an impressive man. He's educated and a determined Kurdish nationalist. So there is leadership in place there, but the Iranian-Kurdish position is so much weaker than it is in the other three states where the Kurds live that there just hasn't been much going on. I must tell you, though, that some scholars think that that is the next Kurdish explosion in Iran. And Iran has the second largest amount of Kurds living in it after Turkey. There are more Kurds in Iran than Iraq, and certainly more than in Syria. Mm-hmm. So the base is there, potentially.
In terms of democratic progress and market economy, the Kurds in Iraq are in the lead. And yet the experience there with both of those isn't that long. We're going back just to the early 1990s. What has accounted for the progress that we've seen on both the economic and political fronts?
The immediate reason was that the United States eliminated Saddam Hussein so that the Kurds in Iraq could become autonomous. And then the United States, to a large extent, supported this experiment in Kurdish autonomy. But the most powerful reason for the growth of the economy and now even the political institutions, Turkey of all things. The Turks have completely turned around their attitude that by a reflex, oppose the Iraqi Kurds as a danger to Turkish territorial integrity. The Turks decided the Iraqi Kurds were not going away. So if you can't destroy them, cooperate with them. So Turkey has cooperated with the Iraqi Kurdish economy, and the Turks have built an enormous amount of infrastructure in Iraqi Kurdistan, and then inevitably the political understandings followed. And now you just hear unbelievable things from where we were a few years ago. The Turkish government refers to President Barzani of the KRG, where a few years ago he was a warlord who did not know much more than tribal boundaries and so forth. So it's Turkey that, for economic and now political reasons, has been so instrumental in the development of the KRG. On the other hand, to the disappointment of the Iraqi Kurds, when ISIS attacked the KRG in August last year, Turkey did not come to its aid. So that shows the KRG the limits of Turkish possibilities here. But still, in the long run, Iraqi Kurdistan is landlocked and surrounded by other countries and has to come to an agreement with them, and that agreement now is with Turkey.
What do you make of Turkey's behavior in all of this, not coming to the aid of Iraqi Kurdistan when they had built up this large economic relationship?
I think Turkey right now is having serious problems of its own. Due to Erdogan has been so successful in the last 10 years in ruling Turkey that it's probably gone to his head. And he's putting a lot of people in prison, including journalists. Exactly what his ultimate aim is in terms of turning Turkey into some type of Islamic state, of which it would be a contradiction to modern secular Turkey founded by Ataturk. We just don't know how far Erdogan is going to want to push Turkey. And part of the problem also is there, although Turkey is a functioning democracy, there is no viable opposition to Erdogan. He can do almost anything he wants to do. And in a functioning democracy, you should have the alternative party, the loyal opposition, who can win the next election potentially and come to power. And there's no such thing in Turkey now. You have Erdogan's party, the AK Party, and two or three other parties that are really almost just half parties, have no chance at all in the elections. So Turkey seems to be very confused about what it's doing now, and I think that has been in part reflected about its attitude toward the Kurds. But some of my contacts in Turkey have told me that we still don't really trust those Kurds. So if there's a chance to have the Kurds smashed by ISIS, maybe we should let it happen and let our two enemies, ISIS and the Kurds, slug it out among themselves, and we'll benefit from that. Maybe a secret motif of the Turks. It's certainly not officially announced, but it's certainly been true in Syria too, where ISIS was attacking the Syrian Kurds, and Kobani became almost legendary in world politics last fall. And Turkey stood by watching that happen. And the Turks explained to me, why should we intervene to save a Kurdish group allied with the PKK who's been trying to dismember Turkey for 30 years, even though we have a peace process with the PKK going on? But how long can the peace process go on if Turkey is allowing the PKK's ally in Syria to be crushed?
Are the Turks safe from ISIS?
I don't think so. In the long run, ISIS has even said it's going to in one way or another, attack Turkey. The ambitions of ISIS had no limits other than physically what's possible. But ISIS has threatened Turkey too, and Turkey knows this. And ISIS could even do it right now, as apparently is going on in Europe with bombings in Istanbul and other cities. We don't have to have ISIS militarily attacking. We can use terrorism of bombings and so forth.
So it seems that it would make sense for Turkey to throw in with the Kurds.
You would think so. And I've certainly argued that. But Erdogan is walking a thin line that he thinks it's better not to throw in with the Kurds, to let the Kurds handle their own situation. And that situation will weaken both ISIS and the Kurds. And Turkey will sit off on the side and not be weakened.
You've studied the Kurds in Iraq, in Syria, in Turkey, and in Iran. Is there some grand volume in the making in which you'll have sections on all of these, sort of a definitive...
Oh, you mean a book?
A book.
Actually, right now, I am writing for Marcus Wiener, a publisher, an academic publisher. He calls it A Short History of the Kurds, which I guess it is, about 80,000 words. And I've written the first chapter, and he's looking at it right now. And if he gives me the go-ahead, I think I can have the book done by June 1st. So it will be a book, short history, short political history of the Kurds that I'm working on right now.
Tell us about the Kurds in the United States. You know more about them than most people. Where are they concentrated? Are they visible in politics and economics and other fields?
In the United States, the Kurds are not much compared to how they are in Europe. In Europe, depending on how you count it, there may be well over a million Kurds. In the United States, nobody really knows, but maybe 40,000 Kurds in the United States. So they're not really that important. The largest mass of them, my hometown, Nashville, Tennessee, about 10,000. But in Nashville, the Kurds are largely about becoming American citizens and getting assimilated. So politically, they're not that active in Nashville. Although Vanderbilt University, a major university in Nashville, is giving a Kurdish course this semester, and I'm invited to give a lecture there sometime in March. So there is some political awareness that there in Tennessee, but the main Kurdish awareness in the United States, I would say, is in Washington, D.C., where Najmuddin Karim lived for many years and formed a strong base of Kurdish lobbying in Washington, Kurds also in California and in New York City.
Thank you for joining us today, Dr. Gunter.
Well, thank you for inviting me.
And thank you. For Global Perspectives, I'm John Bersia. We'll see you next time.